Hello, it's Carly McAvoy. This week's video is about information graphics, and that is a branch of statistics where people take a lot of information and they organize it into an easy-to-read format. Organizing data is not new, but in this age of data coupled with easy-to-use software, everybody is getting into the game. Well, let's go back to some of the early users of this technique of information graphics. In Florence Nightingale, who you might know as a nurse, was actually a lot more than a nurse. She was a statistician. She was also the head nurse, trained nurses, established nursing schools, and a lot more. This was done during the Crimean War when she saw a lot of people dying from what she considered to be preventable causes. And she wanted to convince the medical community to change the practice of washing your hands or cleaning your saw between sawing somebody's leg off or whatever. And so she came up with, these are called the Nightingale Coxcombs. And so when you look at this, if you look at the chart on the right, from the center, let's take this wedge. Each wedge represents a month. And in January, the red part of this wedge shows the people that died from battle wounds. The black part is anything else. And the blue part is people that died from what she considered preventable or mitigable diseases. And so you can see then from this chart that there were way more people dying from diseases and infections than, so they were doing more harm at the hospitals than they were doing good. And so her charts convinced people to change the habits and saved so many lives, and people today still washing their hands to prevent these kind of things happening. So that's an early one. Another early one that has been, some people say, is the best statistical graph ever drawn, was done by Charles Minard. And this has to do with Napoleon's Russian campaign. And there's six different things, and this is hard to read in a PowerPoint slide. And so I urge you, if you're interested, to go look this up. And there's pictures of it all over the internet. But it has six different types of data. The number of Napoleon troops, which are shown by the width of the column, and 1 millimeter equals 10,000 troops. The distance, so there's distances as you go across here of how far they were traveling. There's temperatures at the bottom. It's hard to see, but you can see negative 11 degrees here, and there's temperatures shown. The latitude and longitude is shown. The direction of travel, they were heading this way, then they were heading back. The direction and the location relative to specific dates, there's different cities that are shown in there. And if you drop down, you can see, oh, this was November 14th. So there's all kinds of information in just one two-dimensional graph. And the thing that a couple things that I will point out to you is that over here they started off with 422,000 troops. And then this shows the migration towards Russia. And you can see that the troops, they're losing troops radically just before they ever getting there, right? And so by the time they reach here, they have 100,000 troops. And then the black line is their retreat and as they were coming back. So it shows you kind of where they were traveling, and it shows you how, again, this line starts to get thinner and thinner. And there's one point, I think it's right here, where they were crossing a river, at this river crossing. You can see the line, this goes from 50,000 troops to 28,000 troops. They lost 22,000 troops in a matter of 2 days right here. And then as they continue back, you can see the numbers of troops dropping, 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 and they came back with 10,000 troops. So one out of every 42 people in that campaign made it back. So that's a pretty amazing graphic organizer. Something much more lighthearted, but also was a little depressing to me when I first saw it. There's a lot of times when you'll see just maps of the U.S. with the states color-coded, showing you where's the opioid crisis the worst, or where's the most deaths from vehicles, or where's the most mass shootings occurred, and this one just has to do with who's the highest paid public employee in the state. That's public, so you don't count if you're working for a private organization. But you can see that most states, the highest paid public employee is a football coach. That is if you're in the yellow. The orange are basketball coaches. And then the blue are others, so mostly college presidents or deans of schools of medicine or law. And so we can kind of start to see what we value in this country, or who we value and who we pay the most. Here's one that's a lot more sparse to look at, but it still has a lot of information in it. This is about the prescription opioids, and just first of all gives us the number of citizens that are addicted. They say that 80%, and then it says U.S. consumption of all world prescription opiate supply. So we can assume that means that U.S. is using 80% of all the world supply. That's what I get out of it. I find this chart a little bit confusing. 56 billion per year, that's the U.S. prescription opioid abuse cost, 56 billion. And then in this case, we can say, well, why did they make this an arrow? Are they saying that's rising, or I don't know, or it's above that? I mean, they chose this particular graphic for a reason, but I don't know what that reason was. And then 25% over here, they show 1 in 4, and then you have the 25% there. And then the fact that I found most interesting is workers who use prescription opioids for 3 months or more almost never return to work. We don't know a statistic there, so almost never to them could be 20% due, or I don't know. So that's kind of interesting, and they have little superscripts here that you could go and read more from their website, Lola Farm. Okay, and then this one also has some a little bit questionable to me, but a lot of times when you see these kind of graphics, you can see who wrote it, and you can kind of know the political slant of that group based on how they presented their data. But I have seen this before many times. The lifetime likelihood of incarceration for men is 1 in 9, but for black men is 1 in 3. And that is pretty striking. White men, 1 in 17, Latino men, 1 in 6. And then they have this similar thing for women. And those pictographs where they show the people and then color one of them to show something, that's an effective way that people use a lot. We've seen a couple of those here. The thing that I question here is it says at any given time there are over 2 million people incarcerated in the United States. But then the huge number they show here is 6,937,600. So then that's the individuals under the supervision of adult correctional systems. So I guess that includes people on parole or probation or whatever. But that number stands out, and then you see up here, well, there's actually 2 million. So anyway, still too high of a number in my opinion. But whatever slant we're looking at here, the U.S. easily leads the world in incarceration with over 750 per 100,000 people. And this one is a more lighthearted picture. This one shows the commute time in average commuting time in each state. And they show these little like lines out here for minutes. So this is 51.4 minutes, but the red line shows the average commute, 29.4. And so you can look around and see the average commute time nationwide is 26.6. And I have to tell you, I was a little surprised by this one because I would have guessed it to be longer. Then they also have in here color-coded map, as we talked about, people use that a lot. The darker the pink, that means the longer the commute time, and the green means less, smaller commute time. And then they have little black squares around. Those are talking about the cities with the longest commutes. Notice that Washington State didn't make any of those. And then the yellow ones are the cities with the smallest commute time. And the cities had to be a certain size to get into that, so they didn't use the really small cities. So it's just an interesting way to organize a lot of data. And finally, my favorite data visualization example is Hans Rosling's 200 Countries, 200 Years in 4 Minutes. And originally, I was going to just put that video right into here, but I decided not to do it. I really strongly encourage you to go watch his video. It's not very long, and it's very informational. It's just really interesting the way he organized data. So I took a screenshot of it, and he's showing countries over 200-year span, and I froze it at 1948 because he freezes there for a second. And when you look at this, he's talking about the life expectancy and the income per person and showing how that's changing over time. And then he took the different continents and gave them different colors. So like Asia is red. And then he made the dots bigger for more population or smaller for less population. So there's all kinds of information. Just if we look at one dot, like maybe I think this is China. We can see it's from they're from Asia, that they've got a huge population, and in 1948 they had a pretty low life expectancy and a pretty low income. And then as time goes on, those dots start to move. It's very well done. It's very interesting, and I highly recommend it. So this is a thing, an industry now, where people are organizing, putting information out, and you have to be able to synthesize it a little bit and ask, what's the source? What's the intent of this? And are they trying to be misleading when they do it? But just know that you're going to see it all around you. All right, have a fantastic day, and we'll talk to you next time.